Hello and welcome to the first tutorial in this definitive guide to object-oriented programming in Python and Python classes. This is the definitive guide to object-oriented programming in Python and we'll be going on a journey from novice to advanced by the end of the series. First, a short introduction to help you get the most from this series. I think it's inadvisable, but you can skip this and jump straight to Python objects. That's what we'll be covering today, if you want to. The link is in the description below. This is an 8-week course. As a result, we're going to get pretty advanced, and it also enables you to have regular coding practice in object-oriented programming and Python classes. If you're a beginner, I want you to start from day one. If you're intermediate and you have a lot of knowledge of classes, I think there's a lot of merit in you joining this program, but halfway through, because like I say, at the end, we're gonna be pretty advanced. What I won't be covering is basic introductory Python, the basics of the Python language. If you don't know the basics yet, then I would strongly recommend that you follow one of the excellent beginner tutorials by other people on YouTube. They're easy to find. I want you to faithfully and diligently, meticulously follow every tutorial in this series from day one. This is so that you can develop an advanced, deep, and nuanced understanding of the Python language, the way it uses classes, and object-oriented programming as it relates to Python. We'll be using Python 3 throughout, and the syntax that you'll learn will work on Python 3.x. You can install Python 3 here at the python.org website. What I'll teach you is operating system agnostic, so that means it will work on Linux, Mac, and Windows. You can also follow me along if you install Visual Studio Code here. It's free, it's excellent, and it's available for Windows, Mac, and Linux. If you need to, make sure you check out the documentation. There's an excellent Python part and a tutorial to get you started. Once you've installed it, go ahead and install the Python extension and the Code Runner extension. What the Code Runner extension does is after you've opened a file and you've put all the Python code that you want to run in it, you save it, and all you have to do is press Ctrl+Alt+M and it will run it for you, as shown here. If you find that this doesn't work, then you might have to edit your settings. Go on ahead to Settings, type in Code Runner in the search box, and then you'll see lots of Edit in Settings JSON. Just click on any one of those, and add what I show you here to your file. Make sure there's a comma after the last thing in your settings.json file before you've added this extra path that I'm showing you. Obviously, make sure the path is the path where you have Python installed. Let's get stuck in. Objects in Python are an abstraction for data, and everything in Python is represented by objects or relations between those objects. This is known officially as Python's data model, and that's the term that you'll see in the documentation. Many distinguished Python users prefer to talk of Python's object model. Everything in Python is an object. The data model, the object model, they're both talking about the same thing. An object, and indeed every object, has three things: an identity, a type, and a value. The type enables or restricts what that object can do. So for instance, if we type a equals 1, and we print the type of a, we see that a is an int, short for integer. Whereas if we now make another object, so we've got b equals 1, 2, 3, 4. This is a tuple. When we print the type of b, we confirm that it's a tuple. The function len gives us the length of an object. Print len b is printing the length of b, our tuple, and what we see is 4, as we expect. When we print the length of a, an int, we get an exception. There's no such thing as len for an int. So the type int is restricting, in that sense, what it can do. Let's talk about identity. Once an object's been created, its identity can never change. It's essentially the object's address in memory. We can see what this address is by using the ID function. This integer here is representing A's address in memory. We're going to make our own class at this point, and I'm going to show you how to use the class keyword. I want you to rest assured, I'll be showing you things and introducing you things that might not have the entire explanation at the first time of asking, but that are essential for us to create a scaffold in our minds on which we can then store more information. So, as these tutorials go on, what I'm going to do is expand on things, and your knowledge will increase, and your coding capability will increase in hand. To make a class, we use the class keyword, and then we use the name of our class. The convention in Python is to start the name of a class with a capital letter, so it's Pascal case as opposed to camel case. We then use a colon, and then we press enter. Visual Code has automatically put a tab, or four spaces, after the colon. This is known as the body of the code. The body of the code is where we are at the moment. Everything we type here is going to be associated with the class that we've created. We're not going to put anything in our class, it's just going to be an empty shell. So we type the Python keyword pass. Pass essentially is what you use when you just want to press enter and carry on with the rest of your code, but if you don't put anything there, then Python can't work out what you mean in the rest of your code. So we use the keyword pass to indicate that. We create an instance of our class by typing in the variable name that we would like. So we're using instance here. We're using a lowercase I because the convention is for instances to start with a lowercase letter, so that if we're scanning quickly through our code, we can easily tell the difference. We then put an equals sign followed by the class followed by a pair of brackets. What the brackets do is they call whatever's behind it. So when we have brackets after a function name, we're calling the function. When we have brackets after a class name, we're calling the class. And the class is like a factory for producing objects of that class. So this instance here is just one object of potentially many that we could create, which are all instances of this class. This process on this line is called instantiation. If I print this variable name without anything else, I get something really interesting. Take a look at this. There's two underscores, main, two more underscores, dot. Note that this is a namespace. We're not going to cover that here. We're going to cover that in detail tomorrow. And then we've got the name of our class. These two underscores are called dunder in Python. Double under, double underscore. This is telling us that this object of ours, this instance, is an object of this class. And after that, it's telling us what its memory address is. This whole thing in angled brackets is known as the wrapper of the instance, and it could be very useful. Let's print ID of this object of ours. ID instance. Now remember, I told you at the start, ID and then the object that we pass to ID function gives us the memory address representation. We can see that these two values are not the same at all. Now let's print hex. Hex being a function that returns a hexadecimal value of the base 10 number that we pass to it. And let's print this. As we can see, this is now the same as what's in the wrapper. That's all we've got time for today. This has been a particularly short tutorial because we're just introducing the subject and just whetting your appetite. We'll be back tomorrow where we'll be covering namespaces in depth. See you next time.